Boston Garden. Where are those jubilant cheers of yesteryear? In 1959, Celtic fans started a tradition, a little party. And for a decade, it became an almost annual event, the NBA championship. This year, they've renewed that customary celebration. These festivities are also an anniversary party, commemorating 35 years of NBA championships. Every year, after a grueling regular season schedule, 12 teams begin what has come to be known as professional basketball's second season, the NBA playoffs. In their quest for an NBA title, it's do or die. For these teams, there will be no tomorrow. The concentration and passion is intense for players and fans alike. Their 62 wins have brought the Boston Celtics an Atlantic Division title, and the banner-draped rafters of Boston Garden are proof that playoff time is their time of year. Artis Gilmore and the Chicago Bulls come into this semifinal series on a roll. They knocked off the New York Knicks in their mini-series two straight. They have no intentions of letting Boston end their hot streak. But Boston has other ideas. The Celtics blow the Bulls out in four straight. Artis Gilmore will have to wait until next year. In Philadelphia, it's no wonder that Milwaukee Bucks coach Don Nelson and Philadelphia coach Billy Cunningham look a little concerned. Julius Erving has led the Sixers to a seventh game showdown in this matchup of immovable object versus irresistible force. Playing as if they'd never heard of the home court advantage, neither team is able to put together consecutive wins. In Game 7, Bob Lanier and high-flying Marcus Johnson lead the Bucks back from a 16-point third-quarter deficit. But as always, Dr. J is the man in the clutch for Philadelphia. His aerial acrobatics account for 28 points, 7 rebounds, and 6 block shots. Dr. J has paced the Sixers, but the final minutes of this contest belong to Caldwell Jones. His timely rebounding and scoring in the fourth quarter keep a Bucks lead just out of reach. With 14 seconds to go, CJ's two clutch free throws provide the winning margin in a photo flash finish. The Sixers survive 99-98. The Eastern Conference Final is an inevitable rematch. The Celtics just edged out the Sixers for the Atlantic Division title. These two teams have a history of no-holds-barred postseason play. This series will be no different. The Sixers shocked the Celtics with an opening game win at Boston. The Celtics even the series, but the Sixers return home in high gear. Larry Bird can't get on track, and the Sixers win Game 3 handily. Game 4 is a virtual must-win situation. The Celtics build a 19-point lead. But Bobby Jones and Dr. J combine for 38 points as the Sixers come roaring back. With 7 seconds remaining, the Celtics have a chance to win. But Tiny Archibald elects not to use a final timeout. Bobby Jones plays free safety, and the Sixers preserve a tight victory. It is the Celtics' 11th straight loss in the Spectrum, and only one game from elimination. Many fans wondered about Boston's ability to come back and about Archibald's decision.
We were all second-guessed as to what he should have done, what should have happened, and so forth, and it really didn't look good for us. But I think that best typifies the character of our basketball team. And when we were down 3-1, we just took it a game at a time. And when we set into this Philadelphia series, we said, we're playing. If we're not the best in basketball, we felt they were at the time. And they have to beat us 4 times. Let's don't look at it any other way than that. One of these two great teams has to lose 4 ball games, and until we lose that 4th one, we're still in it.
Indeed, they were still in it. Philadelphia simply could not deliver the knockout punch. In Game 5, Boston rallied from a 6-point deficit on some Larry Bird heroics with less than 2 minutes remaining. Now, back home in Game 6, Philadelphia continued to struggle with a feisty Boston defense. Every basket was a battle. The Celtics simply did not intend to let this one get away. The Sixers can't believe their eyes as they watch a 17-point lead disappear. The scoreboard tells the story as Bird's 18-foot seeing-eye jump shot gives Boston a 3-point edge. Someone up there likes the Celtics today. With seconds remaining, rookie sensation Andrew Toney has the chance to give Philadelphia a lead. But Boston has their own rookie standout. Kevin McHale's clutch rebound forces Philadelphia to give an intentional foul. Billy Cunningham watches helplessly as Cedric Maxwell converts the foul shots and seals Philadelphia's fate. Now it's the Celtics who have a stranglehold on the Sixers. The 11-game Spectrum jinx is over. And with this victory, Larry Bird, who paced Boston with 25 points and 16 rebounds, could feel a definite shift in momentum.
We felt it really shocked him and really tore him apart, because now it's 3-3 and we're coming back to the Garden. And that was just a game, whoever had the most guts and the most determination was going to win that game.
The Sixers have never beaten the Celtics in a 7-game series. And now they are but a loss away from that dubiously distinguished list of only 3 teams which have let 3-1 playoff leads slip away. In the early going, it's Philadelphia who has the guts and determination as they forge a 5-point first quarter lead. The two teams played even through the second quarter, Maxwell picking up 2 of his 19 points on a Boston break. But the period ended on a telling note. Bird's 20-footer is off. Philadelphia fails to box out. Rick Roby rebounds, and Maxwell finally puts it down for the Celtics. The Sixers are glad to head for the locker room with a 5-point lead. The Sixers increase that lead to 11 midway through the third quarter on this Maurice Cheeks offensive rebound and 3-point play. Billy Cunningham has no intention of letting another lead slip away.
If we do not have anything, you cannot hit Doc, we'll hit you. And then our big people go to the baseline, and our guards will set the screen, and we'll pop out. Okay? Now let's give it, let's go, guys.
But Boston has their sights set on an Eastern Conference title. And in a third quarter spurt, outscores the Sixers 10-2, capped by yet another Bird offensive rebound. His layup brings the Celtics within three. Cunningham senses the gathering Celtic storm. And when Robert Parrish retrieves an errant McHale shot, his tally brings the green machine all the way back to deuce. But the Sixers didn't make it this far without a little stubbornness of their own. Dr. J gathers in his own miss, and Philadelphia leads by seven with just 5 minutes and 23 seconds winking on the garden clock. The Celtics suck it in, and a Parrish block ignites a Boston fast break. Bird's foul shots, not the score at 89. And the last minutes of this contest will be the ultimate test of Philadelphia's ability to perform in the clutch.
Okay, now be ready for the good pressure. CJ, you set the screen down here. Okay, for the guard, you can run on the baseball.
The good pressure. Coach, you mean the almost unbearable pressure, if not from a brutal Boston defense, then from a garden crowd which knows how to help its team. With 1 minute and 15 seconds remaining, it's nail-biting time in Boston. Philadelphia has not scored in its last seven possessions. And once again, they fail as center Daryl Dawkins is too strong. Larry Bird with the rebound, because when the chips are down, he welcomes this pressure. Bird's bank shot has boosted Boston to a precious one-point margin. The Sixers have just one shot left to save this series. With 1 second remaining and a frenzied crowd roaring in his ears, Bobby Jones inbounds the ball. But the pass to Irving bounces off the top of the backboard and the game is over. Larry Bird knows that this come-from-behind climax is almost unbelievable.
Well, we really lucked out early in the playoffs because we did win a lot of 1-2 point games. It just seemed like the breaks were going our way. Every time you look up the clock, we had a one-point lead, and there was 1 second on the clock, and they had the ball. It was them type of games where all the emotion, all the adrenaline, and everybody was just flowing, and everything was just going to perfection at the end of the game. We played our best defense in the fourth quarter. We played sound defense, ran our plays, ran real well. But as far as us coming back all the time, a lot of it was just luck. But that was probably the best games I ever played in my life. It was a seven-game series, and every one of them was just full of excitement.
The turnaround for the Rockets was basically a lineup that we were comfortable with, a dedication to defense, and a mental toughness which eliminated our turnovers and cut other team shooting percentages down. A combination of those things got us on a winning track.
Can Billy Paltz mean the Houston Rockets? The reigning champion Los Angeles Lakers can't believe that this 40-42 club is on the brink of dethroning them. These games make heroes of unlikely men, and for Mike Dunleavy, his chance came with just 15 seconds to go in Game 3.
The play was designed for me to get the ball, drag it over to Moses' side, and they overplayed Moses. I thought I had a drive. I went into the middle. Kareem came to help out, so I dished the ball off to Calvin, and then I moved to the open spot and got the ball back, and I was open for about a 17-foot jumper that I put in. It's probably the biggest shot in my career. And it enabled us to get by L.A. and into the next round of the playoffs.
With time running out, Jamal Wilkes inbounds the ball to the $25 million magic man, Irvin Johnson. He'd almost single-handedly defeated Philadelphia with a 42-point performance in last year's final to bring Los Angeles the crown. But Johnson's off-balance shot is short. Moses Malone rebounds, and the Rockets can feel an upset. This is one game Johnson just might not be able to pull out of his bag of magic tricks. The Lakers get the ball back for one last-ditch attempt at salvaging their title. Kareem makes a court link pass to Wilkes, but his desperation shot falls short, and the surprising Houston Rockets can jump for joy. Houston's next stop in their upset odyssey is the Western Conference semifinal in San Antonio. 52 victories brought the Spurs a Midwest Division title, but Houston won't let that bother them in this battle of Texas. Coach Del Harris directs the slow, deliberate offense, which has been the key to Houston's success. Offensive rebounder extraordinaire Moses Malone provides the heavy board work as Houston stuns the Spurs at home in Game 1. San Antonio Coach of the Year Stan Albeck gets his offense going in Game 2 as the Iceman George Gervin and forward Mark Oberdain combine for 58 points to take Game 2, evening the series at one apiece. One Houston player who was beginning to get some long overdue attention was swingman Robert Reed. He'd scored 33 points in a losing cause at Houston in Game 3. And now he and Moses Malone combined for yet another victory at San Antonio in Game 5. Coach Del Harris called on veteran guard Calvin Murphy to start Game 7 at San Antonio as these teams battle down to the wire. Murphy responded with a personal playoff high, pouring in 42 points. Earlier in the season, he'd set a record for foul shots attempted without a miss. Now for Murphy, this victory was proof that Houston was a legitimate contender.
After being in the NBA for 10 years, finishing up my 11th, finally being recognized as not just team to make up the NBA schedule, but a legitimate, good organization with sound basketball players is very important to us.
The other half of the Western Conference semifinal pits the Pacific Division champion Phoenix Suns against another surprise team, the 40-42 Kansas City Kings. Their playmaker, Phil Ford, is injured, and the Kings are heavy underdogs. A balanced Phoenix scoring machine blows the Kings out of Game 1. Coach Cotton Fitzsimmons has a few tricks up his sleeve. He switches forward Scott Wedman and Ernie Grunfeld to the backcourt. And Kansas City surprises Phoenix, winning the next three straight. The Suns battle back, winning games 5 and 6. But the early Kansas City margin is too great to overcome, as power forward Reggie King, Grunfeld, and Wedman join forces to upset the Suns at home and clinch the series. Two teams, which didn't even win half the regular season games, will now play for the Western Conference Championship. Phil Ford returns to the Kings lineup as the teams open their series in Kansas City. But a cold shooting Kings offense, a stalwart Houston defense, and that slow walk-up Houston style put Kansas City on the ropes. When Moses Malone gets the ball down low, he's virtually unstoppable. And so are the Rockets as they snuff out the Kings' Cinderella dreams, clinching the series at Kansas City in 5 games. In 10 playoff wins, this was Houston's sixth road victory. In Billy Paltz's words, their mental toughness and dedication to defense had indeed gotten them on a winning track. No one picked this team to get past the champion Lakers. Now they were on the way to the championship themselves.
To win the NBA championship would be my ultimate dream. I've been playing the game for 9 years right now on the professional level, and every year I said I would like to win the championship, and you know, we're so close right now, and to accomplish that feat would just be, you know, everything that I ever worked for.
It's a boyhood dream, I'm sure, because it's something that, we worked for and dreamed about and we worked on for many years. And it's just something that you wanted to do.
Winning an NBA title would mean an awful lot. That's what we strive for when we put our sneakers on the first day of training camp. It's the goal of every professional basketball player to get the ring.
Welcome to historic Boston, home of baked beans, the Boston Trolley, and a creaky old building just dripping with basketball history known as the Boston Garden. Boston is among the most fervent of sports-minded cities. If there's one thing Bostonians love, it's cheering on their Celtics. For this or any other playoff series, a seat in the Boston Garden has been unavailable for months.
7'1" number 00, Robert Parrish. And forward from North Carolina, Charlotte, 6'8" number 31, Cedric Maxwell. And at the other forward from Indiana State, 6'9", number 33, Larry Bird.
Houston controls the opening tap, and Coach Harris calls the plays.
55!
The Rockets go to work in their methodical style. Billy Paltz is the early spark for the Rockets, connecting on sweeping hooks and hustling rebounds, sometimes with the help of sloppy Boston defense as the Rockets build an early lead. Robert Reed's Jaguar quick drives and jump shots continue to pace the Houston attack. Reed scoring 13 first quarter points.
Get up! Get up right now!
His 17-foot jumper with 2 minutes and 24 seconds left in the first quarter puts Houston up by 12. If it weren't for Boston bench players like Gerald Henderson, ML Carr, Rick Roby, and Kevin McHale, this game might have turned into an early rout. Henderson's 11 second quarter points keep the Celtics afloat. Not until Cedric Maxwell hits these two foul shots do the Celtics take their first lead of the ball game. The lead flip-flop back and forth through the third quarter despite an unusually cold shooting Moses Malone, a man who almost has to score for the Rockets to win. But what one Boston journalist described as the Celtics' what fun is a lead until the final 5 minutes style of play continued to hurt them. Early in the final period, the tenacious Rockets clung to a three-point lead. Then this, an absolutely breathtaking flying follow-up of his own missed 20-footer by who else? Larry Bird. Red Auerbach called this the greatest play I've ever seen. That was the spark as Bird took control of the game in a dazzling display of all-around skill. With 2 minutes and 54 seconds to go, this Maxwell stuff was the Celtics' eighth unanswered point, giving them a 96-91 advantage.
Put your heads back in the game and remember what we got to do to win.
With 30 seconds remaining, the Celtics lead by a single point. Tiny Archibald calls the play, looking for Bird.
Bird posted.
Robert Parrish takes the shot. It's short. And once again, Larry Bird is in the right place at the right time. Rebound number 20, and then 21. And finally, his sixth fourth quarter point on the offensive board. Larry Bird refused to allow the Celtics to let this one get away.
Ever since I've been in college or in pros, the ball has always came to me. They always want me to do the final shooting or try to hit the last second shot. They go to me 80 or 90% of the time. I want the ball because I'm supposed to produce them situations. Sometimes I do and sometimes I don't, but I want the ball in a crucial situation.
I think Larry Bird can beat you even if he doesn't score a point on the basketball court.
Of course, scoring points is one thing Larry Bird does best. And no one knows this better than the man with the very tough assignment of trying to check him, Robert Reed.
To me, the man is a very smart player. He's thinking the whole time once he's on the floor. He's not very fast, so he has to use his mind and try and outthink you.
Larry Bird has been outthinking opponents all season long. The variety of categories in which he leads his team is evidence, as Del Harris knows, of his remarkable all-around skill.
It can be very frustrating because you can do a good defensive job on Larry for maybe 75, 80, 90% of the game even, and yet every time you make a mistake, every time you fail to concentrate and let up, Larry will find a way to hurt you, maybe with rebounding, maybe with passing, maybe a steal, it may be a hoop, maybe a drive, maybe a dish off, but he'll find a way to hurt you.
Bird's concentration and dedication to the game is total. Mental intensity and physical intensity go hand in hand at playoff time. And as a team leader, Larry Bird knows his role well.
Well, I think my job in this series is just go out and play my game, play my typical game, get some assists, really hit the boards well, and score not a lot of points, but enough to keep our team going. Because I know when we go down in the final minutes of the game, we're going to bring the ball to me no matter if we're up or down. I know I got a talent and a lot of people don't have, and I just try to go out and do my best for the fans.
Boston fans have seen a lot of basketball talent come and go. They know class when they see it, and so does Coach Bill Fitch.
Larry Bird is a fantastic basketball player. I've run out of adjectives and words to describe Larry Bird. If you play backgammon with Larry Bird, if you play marbles with Larry Bird, you better be out to win because that's the only way he's going to play the game.
The Houston Rockets know that they've let the Celtics off the hook in Game 1. And they know what they have to do in order to earn a second game victory, especially Moses Malone.
They go to the board real well. You know, they get out and run. We got to stop their running game. We got to play tough defense, and we got to be tough man when we got to play against the Boston Celtics.
No one need impress Moses Malone with the gravity of the Rockets' task. And Malone wastes no time going about his business. That business is scoring points, often in spectacular fashion. Malone has been a thorn in many a coach's side. One statistic that disturbs a coach more than any other is his opponent's offensive rebounds, and that is Malone's specialty. Box out is often a futile cry with Malone lurking near the boards. Malone is so skilled at his craft that defenders often find there's only one way to cope with the powerful rebounder. Don't foul him, grab him, or it's a sure 2 points. Of course, one coach who is glad to see Malone do his thing is Del Harris.
So
certainly to have a man like Malone on our team is an advantage to the coach because you always have that ace in the hole, and it's an advantage to the rest of the players because he draws so much defense that our other players don't have to be quite as good an NBA basketball player to be effective because they're only getting about 75% attention on defense oftentimes.
Billy Paltz agrees.
Whether it's Maxwell or a Bird playing myself, and they're also conscious of helping out on Moses Malone, it gives me an opportunity to get some easy shots.
Moses Malone is one of the rare type players that can, he's the Bill Russell, he's the Wilt Chamberlain type that can turn a game around. Watching him operate on the offensive board is really something else.
This Malone three-point play, his 31st point, pulls the Rockets within one with just 4 minutes and 36 seconds remaining in the game.
Get Malone with the first one, he's done. Look at him first.
4 minutes later, the Rockets cling to a one-point lead as Malone pulls down his 15th rebound and calls timeout. The Rockets need an insurance basket.
All right, you're setting a pick here. We got Al and Paltz. Al and Paltz set this pick here. Malone, you go. If he's wide open, give it to him. If not, curl to the ball side, Malone. To the ball side if you don't get the lob. Break out, get the ball, and try to turn right down to Malone. We want to get the shot in the next 5 seconds if we can.
Once again, the Rockets call on Malone in a critical situation. Flirting with an upset all night, the Celtics have turned the ball over 22 times for 31 Rocket points. Now, it all comes down to this. Dunleavy inbounds to Reed. Reed to Allen Level. Level looks for Malone, but the big guy can't get free. Level drives the baseline with a trio of Celtics contesting his shot.
Way to go, Al!
The 12-footer is good, and the biggest score in Allen Level's short professional career gives the Rockets a critical three-point margin, just 28 seconds from a brand new playoff.
Everybody listen now. You got to play just good, solid position defense. We're ahead three.
No threes.
Don't go trapping or taking any silly chances to steal. We want to play position so that if they do score, it's a tough shot over a hand, right? All right, we're in the bonus, so we don't want to foul the shooter. Whatever you do, don't foul the shooter. Hey, we're talking good, solid 30 position defense. You're going to be on the three-point shooter. But it's position. You're right there. You're not going to let him dribble around you. Don't let Tiny have a quick situation.
With 5 seconds remaining, Tiny Archibald's 17-footer bounces high off the rim, and Houston escapes with a split. This contest was like the race between the tortoise and the hare, and the Rockets' victory is a testament to Coach Harris's gospel of controlled offensive basketball. This is Houston's first win over Boston in 15 tries and their 8th playoff victory on the road, an NBA record. With what is ridiculously referred to as the home court advantage in this curious 1981 playoffs, the Rockets return to Houston. This futuristic landscape contrasts as sharply with Boston's antique charm as do the Rockets and Celtics styles of play. Game 3 is a landmark event in Houston sports history. The Rockets will become the first established pro franchise in Houston to ever host a world championship. The Rockets enjoyed the last laugh in Game 2, and Boston did not take kindly to that humbling experience. Right from the start, Boston makes it clear they do not intend to let Houston embarrass them again. The first half for Houston is a lesson in frustration.
Call him John! You saw that! 2 fouls!
At the half, the Rockets can only muster a mere 30 points. Breaks or no breaks, this game is a brawl. Whoever said basketball is not a contact sport? Frustrated by an inspired and aggressive Boston defense, Houston tempers begin to run a little hot. Coach Harris attempts to reverse a deteriorating situation with some constructive criticism.
We have to work our tail ends off to get a basket and let them run the full court and nobody challenge.
But to no avail as Boston continues to increase its margin. Cedric Maxwell paces the Celtics with 19 points, and this hook shot puts Houston down by 21. The Rockets are snake bit. They shoot a dismal 24 for 79 from the floor. As Coach Harris would later lament, we missed an awful lot of good shots. Houston had been able to win despite low shooting percentages in the past, but today, even their usually firm grip on game tempo had deserted them. As they say down in Texas, the Rockets couldn't hit a bull's butt with a base fiddle.
Swing it back around!
With a game-leading 23 points, only Malone was effective offensively. And in the fourth quarter, his teammates couldn't get him the ball.
Look for Malone! Swing it! Back!
The Rockets simply could not get a ball to drop or a call their way. Houston is never in it. After erasing the Celtics' home court advantage in Game 2, the Rockets come up empty, scoring a team season-low 71 points. Not since Syracuse lost to Fort Wayne in the 1955 championship series has any team scored so few points in the finals. Game 4 was played the very next day, and the Rockets' serious demeanor was an indication of the game's importance. Another bad performance would leave Houston with a 3-1 deficit and a long trip back to Boston. As it was, they were already the biggest underdogs to fight for a title since Rocky Balboa. But the Houston fans didn't see it that way. Yet another sellout crowd in the Summit added boisterous support to their hero's grim-faced sense of purpose. Malone, Paulson, Reed. These five men and swingman Bill Willoughby are the only Rockets Del Harris will play in Game 4.
See, we're getting it over here on one side. Always give Malone a chance. Every time down, give him a chance. So get it over here one time. Then if you don't have it, run your red or whatever comes up. But don't just take it to one side and kill it there.
Harris's strategy is simple. Get the ball to Malone, even if it takes a little while. Guard Mike Dunleavy tells it his way.
Basically, we're trying to go to Moses for the first 15 or 18 seconds on the clock, and then after that, anything that is open, you have the opportunity to go on your own.
In Game 4, that's exactly what Mike Dunleavy did. His unexpected offensive outburst gave the Celtics defense another dimension to worry about. The score was tied at the half, but Dunleavy scored 13 of his game-high 28 points in the third quarter, and the Rockets had a lead they would not lose. Dunleavy's performance overshadowed another good game from Robert Reed.
I think every player wants to be known as a good ball player. Now, hopefully, when this series is over with, everybody will know who Robert Reed is.
Reed is a native Texan, and down south, it's just plain Bobby Joe. Though Reed started at forward, he also filled in admirably in the backcourt. Dale Harris's no tomorrow strategy was working. His six Iron Men had Bill Fitch flustered and almost ready to throw in the towel. Only an NBA championship would put a smile on this man's face. In addition, there was the distinctive board work of Moses Malone, who grabbed 9 offensive rebounds and 22 caroms in all. As the clock ran down, the Houston spirits were up, and all Harris had to do was tell his players the obvious.
Match up, no fouls, be right with them. Don't let him create them.
Harris needn't have worried. The Celtics made only 30% of their fourth quarter shots and were thoroughly frustrated in their efforts to get back in the game. Even reliable Larry Bird had an off game, totaling only 8 points. When in trouble, the Celtics like to lean on Bird, but in Game 4, Boston didn't have a leg to stand on. In a must-win situation, Houston thoroughly outplayed the Celtics and evened the series at 2 games each. The Rockets had earned a return engagement at Boston Garden. Now that the Rockets were only 2 wins away from a world championship, Houston was turning skeptics into believers.
People that asked about why we were 40-42 have to take into consideration a number of things. Partly that we were the second most injured team that got in the playoffs, but principally the fact that in the final games and in of the season in the playoffs, we've been able to play Moses for 46 or 48 minutes, Robert Reed for 45, 48 minutes. You haven't had to work in substitutions like you have to over an 82-game schedule.
I don't think the Celtics are really that great. I think they do a lot of things to make them great. When the game get down to the line, you know, seem like all their players play together and come together, don't make too many mistakes. They know what they got to do. But Boston can be beat.
Boston can be beat, but it's a lot harder to do in Boston Garden. Something about those banners hanging in the rafters and that familiar parquet floor inspires the guys in the white shirts to win as often as the good guys do in the Westerns. When visiting players hear the closing words of the national anthem and the roar of 15,320 Boston fans, they are reminded of the old Celtics, whose success in the Garden was considered their birthright. It's a lonely place for a visiting fan, but the Rockets felt that a team effort could overcome any obstacle. The two teams traded baskets for 6 minutes until a 16-1 Celtic burst gave them a commanding first quarter lead. Second quarter was more of the same, and the Celtics built up a 22-point halftime lead. The main reason was power forward Cedric Maxwell. Cornbread's powerful inside moves consistently paid off for the Celtics throughout the finals, but particularly during Game 5. Maxwell's 15 rebounds and 28 points were both game highs, but even when he's not scoring, Cornbread is a leader in team spirit. And it's infectious. Witness Chris Ford on the bench.
We have a great deal of enthusiasm on this team. It's very much like a college team. There's a lot of rah-rah patting one another on the back and believing in one another. When you're not out there on the floor, you're on the bench cheering and pulling for the guy that's out there trying to do the job. There's no ill feeling towards another guy just because he's out there playing and you're sitting on the bench. We actually pull for one another, and I think that's what's gotten us this far.
After After their fifth game romp, the Celtics found that they weren't the only ones celebrating. Boston fans also deserved a pat on the back.
So I'd say the fact that they're backed by the city is key. I say the crowd in Boston is different anywhere else.
The Celtics are wunderbar.
The Celtics are the best.
Celtics are
Celtic
great.
Fanaticism borders on blind devotion.
We're going to take it four straight all the way. Celtics number one.
Number one.
Number one.
Celtics are number one in my heart and in my mind.
Always a horse racing fan, but I love the Celtics now.
There you go.
They're the greatest.
Celtics, we got them.
You certainly can't blame the Boston supporters for sharing the Celtics' glory. Game 5 of the Houston series was the 30th consecutive sellout in Boston Garden. And judging by appearances, that string of packed houses is just the beginning. This is a new generation of Boston fans, and their heroes are not Russell, Cousy, and Charmin, but rather Parrish, Maxwell, and Bird. Still, it is a tradition nearly as old as the Celtics themselves. A Celtic ticket is rarely bought just before game time. Generally, they are purchased weeks in advance, and the fans prepare for games as if they were participating themselves. In many ways, they are.
All right, party!
It is generally agreed that Boston is the toughest place in the NBA to win, unless you happen to be a Celtic. But win or lose, anyone who visits Boston Garden leaves impressed, and that includes Houston coach Del Harris.
The Boston crowd is a traditional crowd. They've been coming here. They know the players. They know all the nuances, how to help their team get up, how to maybe get on the referees a little bit. In Houston, we won't have quite that kind of a crowd, and in fact, we'll have a couple thousand, maybe 3,000 Celtic fans who have pioneered their way down to Houston.
This is not to say that the Celtics have the only good fans around, because whatever Houston fans lack in experience, they certainly make up for with their enthusiasm.
No, I don't believe it. Rockets, NBA, all right.
Just love them, always have.
Hey, man, it's surprise team of the year.
Well, we didn't think they'd make it this far, truthfully, but now that they have, we're really behind them.
I think they're great, and just glad to be here to witness it, because I know they're going to win today.
Rocket game, the Summit sports enough red and gold to shame even a New England countryside in October. The arena is filled with posters, pennants, t-shirts, banners, and every other artifact imaginable to indicate the fans' support of their team. This is basketball down-home style. You can bet Del Harris and his team were glad to return home from Boston. All of that Celtic green can make a guy see red. As the teams lined up for the sixth game of the series, the biggest question mark was Larry Bird. In the third, fourth, and fifth contests, Bird averaged less than 10 points a game. And for the Rockets to force a seventh game, they would have to stop him again. But Larry Bird would not be stopped. Not on this night. After a frustrating series, Bird found his lost shooting touch and with it regained the rest of his game. Bird is hot, he is nearly impossible to defend. In the sixth game, Robert Reed tried everything, but even when Reed forced a miss, Bird managed to score.
And Bob, you're 100% on Larry Bird. Now wait a minute.
Reed had actually outscored Bird in the first half, but Del Harris felt that Reed's defensive play should come first.
And whenever somebody releases a shot, I want you putting a rear end on him. He's got two offensive rebounds already. Don't want him to have any more.
But what Del Harris wanted was not at all what Larry Bird had in mind. If number 33 wasn't shooting, he was passing. Or rebounding. Larry grabbed 13 missed shots in Game 6 to lead the Celtics in that category. But it was on the offensive end of the floor that his presence was most significant. Bird's 8 third quarter points turned a nip and tuck game into a sizable Boston advantage. With an NBA title at stake, Del Harris called time to regroup.
We get out there. All right, now look, we got to take our time on offense. We're behind, but we don't want to get in a hurry. We got to get the points by executing.
Execute. With the season on the line, Del Harris went back to basics. The Celtic lead actually got as large as 17 points, but Houston was ready for one final stand. Calvin Garrett's hot shooting off the bench led the way, and the lead was cut to 6. The Rockets were back in it, and they were on a tear. This time, it was Bill Fitch and the Celtics who needed a breather. When play resumed, the Celtics got the ball to Larry Bird, and he knew what to do with it. With only a minute and a half left, Bird hit this three-pointer, and the Celtic lead went from 3-6. Now, every possession counted. Robert Reed missed from inside the lane, but somehow he got his own rebound and the benefit of a goaltending call. The lead was back to 4. But that was as close as it got. Cedric Maxwell scored 4 points in the final minute and 20 seconds to guarantee the Celtics victory and sew up the MVP award for himself. Now all the Celtics had to do was hold on.
You still have 20 seconds.
Look, you handle the basketball defensively. You saw where they're going for the three-pointer.
Yeah.
Cover, put a hand up, but you rebound with 5 guys.
Yeah.
Now listen, you're 1 rebound away from letting a smile on my face. I swear, if you get a rebound, I'll smile.
Here we go.
In the old days, with only seconds on the clock, Coach Red Auerbach's lit cigar meant another championship. But these days, Boston players will settle for a smile from their coach. With time running out and the Celtics playing keep away, it was easy to imagine another group of Celtics from a different era doing exactly the same thing. The names and faces have changed, but the uniforms are the same, and so are the results. Surely, this is a dynasty renewed.
For Houston and for that basketball team that's sitting in the Houston locker room. It was a great series, and we're just proud to have that championship trophy because of the amount of talent we had to beat to get it.
All right. Red, take
your Red, did you ever get tired of this?
Never, never, never. And I'll tell you one thing. We got off to 13, we're on to 14. They were simply tremendous.
Fantastic.
They really showed a lot of character all the way through. I think Fitch, Harry, the ball players, they all came through. I'm so proud of them, like any other championship. Yahoo!